quick disclaimer before you listen to this episode. I did get one of my facts wrong. I said the president of South Korea was most likely a progressive, but it turns out after doing a bit more research, he is actually part of the People Power Party, which is their conservative party. But my point still stands. He did not act like a conservative. He acted more like a progressive in his actions and some of the things he's done in the past. But in my opinion, he would be considered something closer to a rhino in America, Republican in name only, or he's just basically a run-of-the-mill politician who's corrupt, which there are a lot of those in America, both Democrats and Republicans. I think he would fit into that category, despite him being part of a conservative party. That's my opinion, and I hope you enjoy this episode. Welcome to another episode of the Sober Minded Podcast. And in this episode, we'll be discussing some world news, some things that have been happening in the world, particularly with what's been going on in South Korea. If you haven't seen what's been going on there, I'll briefly discuss that and also dive into some other things that have been going on with South Korea and kind of the problems that they've been having recently and potentially could be a mirror image of what will happen to America in the future. But I do want to get into the topic at hand. It'll be my jumping point to talk about some other things, some other issues. So what's happened recently is that the South Korean president declared martial law. And if you're not familiar with what martial law is, here is the definition. And this is from the Office of Justice Programs from the U.S. Department of Justice. And so their definition is martial law involves the temporary substitution of military authority for civilian rule and is usually invoked in time of war, rebellion, or natural disaster. Slightly confusing way of phrasing it, but basically what they're saying is that civilian rule is replaced by military authority. When martial law is in effect, the military commander of an area or country has unlimited authority to make and enforce laws. When a leader in a country claims martial law, it's usually not something that is easily lifted or easily discontinued until the reason that it was enforced or the reason that it was put into rule or put into action is done with. So, for example, if there is a war that breaks out, martial law is declared, and therefore the military has the right to enforce and make laws over the civilians without regard for the natural processes of democracy, for example. And so it's not something that's easily done away with until the war or until the battle is over. The South Korean president did declare martial law, and here's a short video kind of detailing what exactly happened.
Tuesday night in South Korea, the main television channel shows a popular chat show.
And this is from Channel 4 News. It's a British broadcasting
network. Until the president breaks into the evening schedule and spoils it with a national address that shocks the nation. President Yoon declares martial law, putting the military in charge. He blames pro-North Korean opposition parties who make up the majority in parliament and who've been blocking his legislation.
So his reason on the front of the issue, or on the face of the issue, his reason that he says is because that there's North Korean opposition parties, or in other words, parties that are influenced by North Korea opposing South Korea, that are blocking his legislation that he's trying to pass. Because he thinks there's some sort of coup that's happening against him, he launches the martial law in order to shut down the government so that these people can be removed, right? That's the story that he's going with. But he already has a low approval rating, I've seen, and you know, a lot of people just don't like the way he's been handling things, I guess, and I don't know all the details, but that's certainly, he does not favored in South Korea. And so they still have a law that is able to take place in their parliament to revoke the martial law declaration. But martial law is still, and you can see the soldiers here invading certain areas or whatever. Again, I don't know all the details of exactly what they're doing. Parliament does have a choice to revoke the martial law. And there's you know, politicians, government officials rushing to parliament to vote to reverse the decision. Here's another member of parliament who's trying to grab the gun from one of the soldiers, which is a dumb thing to do. You never want to grab a gun or rifle from someone, because by instinct, if they're not trained, they'll pull the trigger and you'll die doing that. So that's kind of a dumb thing. But that's besides the point. So what happened, this all happened midnight in South Korea, Tuesday midnight in South Korea. And what eventually happens is that Parliament does revoke the martial law, and they reverse the decision after this had gone on for at least 2 hours. And then there's also some people saying that it's done with, it's over, and other people are saying that there are still soldiers stationed in various areas. So it's kind of interesting to see they had actually got this far and that they were able to reverse it. I think in most cases, martial law can't really be that easily reversed. So I think there's maybe something else going on here. Again, I don't know everything there is to know about this situation or about South Korea politics and the government and things like that. But it does seem like it was kind of easier than you'd expect to reverse a martial law decision. So there might be something else going on behind here. But I also want to point out, and this is where this branches off into other areas, other things that we can talk about, other things that are interesting in regards to South Korea. So moving away from this whole martial law thing, it appears to be done and, you know, wrapped up. You have to consider that this person who was elected, you know, in by the parliament, by the people, he was elected to be the president of the South Korea. That kind of decision is not made out of nowhere. Like, it was obviously something, you know, when someone does something crazy, there's a pattern that you can see beforehand. So it's not really, it might be a surprise once they do something crazy, but there's definitely a pattern before that that shows you that this person had the potential to make a crazy decision or to do something crazy, very dangerous to other people. In a particular, we're talking about the president of South Korea here, and that decision to declare martial law over something that kind of a lie. I don't want to say it's a total, you know, maybe he's saying the truth to some degree, but obviously he does have a pattern of behavior that shows that he's kind of a cowardly, selfish kind of person. That's what I've seen from, you know, people who are more involved in this situation. But there was that pattern before that, and he was, you know, elected by people. So I'm interested to see what kind of policies he ran on. You know, why did people vote him? My guess is that he had a, you know, progressive voter base. Because if you're not aware, South Korea has become very progressive, very leftist in some ways, but nonetheless, very progressive, and has moved away from their conservative values and the conservative values that you'd expect from an Asian country. They're accelerating, they're progressing at a rate that is much faster than Japan or China. And it has led to a lot of problems, especially looking at it from a Christian perspective. And of course, we look at everything, Christians look at everything from a Christian perspective. It's kind of hard not to. But, you know, really focusing on what that means for Christianity in Korea, there's been more and more opposition going on between the culture, the society, the people of Korea, and enacting laws and things that harm Christians, you know. And there's a stigma against Christianity, and that goes for all Asian countries. But China and Japan do have their, you know, very strong Christian presence in certain areas. Same goes for South Korea. But what's been happening recently is that South Korea has been progressing and has been going more towards leftist ideals, that they, it's sort of a, to do any sort of Christian work over there is going to be very hard to do that, which is not a new challenge that Christians are facing. Christians have been, you know, proclaiming the gospel and evangelizing, teaching the Bible in places that are very dangerous, you know, places where you'd get killed for teaching those kind of things. So this is, hasn't gotten to that degree yet, but this is still a problem that will be increasing over time. And on top of all that, you have South Korea adopting very modern Western principles, not really principles, just trends and fads and things like that, especially when it comes to feminism. Western feminism was pretty much imported into South Korea, so much so that they've been popular recently for developing what's called the 4B movement, if you haven't heard of this. It's also called the 4 no's, like no. And basically what that means is that there are four things that women have collectively decided, or that this radical group has decided, that all women have decided this in South Korea, that they will not give birth, they will not date men, they will not marry men, and they won't have intimate relations with men. I'll put it that way. You know, this didn't happen in a vacuum. but South Korea has one of the lowest birth rates in the world, and it's not, you know, for no reason. It's because there is an effort. There's this feminist effort that's going on over there, which has led to this ideology flourishing in South Korea. Now, Japan also has a very low birth rate, but in terms of what's causing it, it's not really feminist ideas. They do have some of it. They do have an emphasis. Recently, they've had a greater emphasis on women building careers. And that seems kind of something that's sort of old, but because we look at it from an American mindset, you know, women having their own careers was kind of a battle that was fought in the 70s and 80s. Not a good battle. Feminists had to fight to have that sort of thing happen, and now it's sort of commonplace to have, you know, women pursuing careers. And overall, it's had a detrimental effect on society. And so Japan has been facing that recently. China, not so much, because they do have a government that enforces the cultural and conservative values, and they enforce it to the degree where it does become a problem in some areas. For example, they have completely ostracized Christianity from most of China, and they do pretty heavy persecution on Christians. So that's one of the downsides of having a government that enforces their traditional values, because a part of their traditional values is to, one of their traditional values is to persecute Christianity. So that's why it is, so that's why China is the way that it is now, and which is why Korea is becoming much worse now, because they've been completely influenced by the West so much that they've been having issues with feminism and also transgenderism. I think just recently there was a piece of legislation that passed that allowed, you know, men and women to use whatever bathrooms they want. There's no gendered bathrooms or something like that. I don't remember exactly what the thing was, but there was something like that that recently passed. And there's been other things like that that I've seen, small bits and pieces of it here and there, concerning the same, you know, feminist policies that have been, that are being passed and talked about, and, you know, the victories for women everywhere in South Korea. That's, they always like to say it like that. They like to make it seem like it's a good thing, when in fact, when you look at the big picture, it's not a good thing for any culture, because as you see, birth rate is lowering, one of the lowest birth rates. I believe it might be worse than Japan at this point. Not totally sure. That does sound kind of like something that's hard to believe, because I think Japan has been one of those places where it's been maybe like the top three or top five worst. But I think Korea might have surpassed them. I don't know exactly what the ranking is on lowest birth rates in the world. But that's eventually what this leads to. And it's kind of ironic that these people who spread these ideologies, ultimately, they're going to die out with their ideologies, because they're not going to propagate. They're not going to have children to instill these values to, which is a good thing. It's sort of like a, I guess you could say, it's a common grace. It's something that, you know, it's naturally reveals itself. Of course, these people who have these evil ideologies, feminism, which is harmful to women and to the entirety of society, harmful to men, harmful to everyone. These ideologies are not going to really survive, because they're not going to have anyone to pass it on to. And the reason for that is, even if you teach young people this prevalently, the people who don't hold these ideals are going to be the majority of people. So soon it's not going to matter. There'll be a certain point to where it doesn't matter, because most people will not agree with those ideologies. But it is going to be sort of like an ebb and flow. You know, when you look at the big picture of history, there you see an ebb and flow. You see it ebbs towards, you know, leftist ideology, and it's going to revert back to conservative ideology, and it's going to go back and forth. There are these ebbs and flows within societies and cultures. Sometimes it's a lot quicker, sometimes it's a lot slower. And with Korea, I think it's in the case that it will be a lot quicker, because we've seen so much progress being made in a short amount of time comparatively to America and other Asian countries such as China and Japan. So to wrap this back to the initial story, I think this South Korean president who declared martial law, the reason he did that is he probably had a leftist base that he was working from. So the people who voted for him were leftist, and he leans leftist. And now he's doing something that you would expect a leftist to do, for a reason, you know, that a leftist would do, because they believe that there is an oppositional party among the parliament. And you could totally see someone like Biden doing that. someone like Kamala would definitely, well, Biden and Kamala would be told to do something like that. I don't think they, if either of them were still president, they would not be, you know, certainly they wouldn't be acting on their own volition. They would be doing what they're told. But you take any sort of leftist, and if they believe that there's this problem among their government, they could easily do that. You know, people always blame conservatives and Republicans for being strict and for being, despotic, like being dictators. Dictators remove freedom. They remove the freedoms that people have, and they put laws in place that restrict people from having certain freedoms. And we've only seen that coming from the left with, you know, censoring freedom of speech, censoring freedom of the press. And when you look at it from a moral standpoint, leftists are largely immoral compared to conservatives. Obviously, conservatives aren't perfect. There are certain things that conservatives vote on that wouldn't necessarily be Christian. But once you put the two ideologies side by side, you see that conservatives certainly have a lot more positives in terms of moral and ethics and Christian morals, Christian ethics, comparatively to leftist ideology. So conservatives always win in that setting. But regardless of that, this idea that conservatives are despotic or dictatorial is really unfounded, because conservatives, particularly in the American context, want to conserve the freedoms that Americans have. Whereas progressives, it's in their name, they want to progress, and the way that they progress, past tradition, past the core values of America, the way that they progress is by stripping all those freedoms away and by, you know, telling everyone that they know better and that they know what everyone should be doing. And so in order to, you know, get people to do what they want them to do, they have to remove these freedoms. Because if we have the freedom to do whatever we want, you know, obviously it's not really that kind of freedom that we have in America, which is a good thing. We shouldn't have wanton freedom. There should be restrictions, moral restrictions, ethical restrictions to our freedoms. But the progressive answer to that problem is to add more restrictions. And those restrictions are a part of their own twisted code of morals and code of ethics, which is totally opposed to Christianity. So once again, this leader of South Korea certainly was not a surprise. And I don't know this for sure with 100% certainty, but I'm pretty sure that the president of South Korea did have a progressive base and was voted because of that. I might have to do more research. Look, if I'm wrong, I'll mention it in the next episode. But for now, that's my guess. But I do want to point out that it wasn't that long ago in Korea, or really any Asian country for that matter, where almost like the top three values of those countries was top three values to be content. The top three values were family, tradition, and honor. So it might seem kind of like a stereotype, the honorable samurai in terms of Japanese and things like that. But that stereotype didn't come out of nowhere. There was a code of conduct. There was a code of honor that was built into these Asian societies. It was, you didn't want to do things that dishonored your family. And that's become kind of a joke now. And see, you know, a lot of people joke about this. Well, they used to, and not really something that's joked about anymore. But it was something that was joked about. You also had the stereotype of the smart Asians, right? Because they were instilled at a very young age to do the best that they can in education, and to strive harder, right? To not dishonor their parents. And so that was a big deal in Asian societies. And then increasingly, you know, just like it happened in America, increasingly you had, you know, throughout the years, year after year, you had this chipping away at those traditional Asian values. And now it's gone to the point where some parts of those Asian countries are pretty much undiscernible between modern American culture, which is really a shame, because Asia still has a lot of good things about it. East Asia, and again, I'm talking about the three main countries that I'm talking about here are South Korea, Japan, and China. They still do have some good things about their structure, their moral code, and some of the traditions that they still hold on to. There's a lot of good things about that. But at the same time, it's you can't really have those traditional values coincide with the modernist values that are being instilled in them and that are being that are growing in these countries at the same time. You can't have those two sides at the same time. And inevitably, they're going to be overtaken, as we've seen with the birth rate decreasing. As we've seen, these countries will be overtaken with those feminists, with those progressive ideologies. And it's not going to be good for these countries. But at the same time, the silver lining, like I mentioned earlier, these ideologies won't stay around forever. They're going to die out with the people that hold them because they won't be around long enough to regenerate these ideas for to the next generation. But instead, we'll have Christians who are instilling their families, right? Christians are having children. We have a more of a spiritual incentive to have children. And so Christians will be able to produce offspring and raise them in righteousness and with these Christian ethics and morals, so that when they grow up, they'll do the same with their children. The cycle just continues of Christian values being instilled from family to family, from generation to generation. And so that will continue on while these other ideologies that are opposed to Christianity, or these other ideologies, leftist, feminist ideologies, progressive, modernist ideologies, won't have that same generative effect. And so essentially they'll die out with the people that hold them. And then if those ideologies come back, so let's say years from now, you have Christians reading a history textbook and they hear about these feminist ideas, they will be less likely to adopt those ideas if they have that good Christian structure that they were born with. They won't be swayed by, you know, reading about feminism in textbooks. Now, whether that's going to happen or not, I don't know. Who knows what's going to happen in the future? It could be a lot worse. It could be Christianity could be just totally outlawed in America or in South Korea and Japan or China. It hasn't gotten to that point yet, but certainly Christianity does have that generative effect from generation to generation, whereas these feminist, these progressive ideologies don't have the same effect. So I think that's a good thing in the long term for Christianity, and not a good thing for these leftist ideologies. Well, it's not a good thing for them, but it is a good thing overall. And then, and we see young people, you know, Generation Z. I think there's been like some study or some statistic that was heading back to church in larger numbers than millennials. I don't know how old that data is, but it is something that is noteworthy. But I think that's what the stat said. I could be totally wrong on that, but I'm pretty sure that's what I read a couple years ago. So to wrap up this episode, I think what happened in South Korea could be a sign of larger problems. Well, I think it is a sign of larger problems, but it could be a sign that there is something worse in the future for South Korea because it's been accelerating so quickly. I mean, you would never hear about martial law being declared in a place like Japan. And it's very upsetting because I do keep a close eye on Asian culture and how it's developing, how it's been developing over the years, and some of the history. I've looked at some of the history of Korea and Japan and China. And so to see that they're heading in this direction is very upsetting. It's very disheartening because there are a lot of things I respect about Asian culture. And, you know, it's kind of like they're correct on a lot of things in terms of value, such as family and tradition and work ethic. Although their work ethic has been kind of twisted around, especially in Japan. Definitely in China. China has gone totally in the leftist direction, to the point where it is very despotic. And then you have a place like Hong Kong, which is almost the complete opposite. It's also very influenced by Western ideals as well. So China is an interesting case because you kind of see both sides of the coin there. But in South Korea, I guess it's also similar in South Korea, in the Korean Peninsula, we'll say. Very similar there because you have North Korea and then South Korea. And there you see two sides of the same coin. Whereas Japan is a lot different because they're a lot more cohesive. They're not very divided. They're still pretty much unified in their traditional values in one sense. But then again, there's also another kind of society, another culture is going on in the background of Japan where you see a lot of these bad things going on and things like that. But Korea is really, really not been in a good place, especially when you consider its effect on its influence on social media. You know, they have filters that make you look Korean, and they have a huge influence on the beauty market. Even in the gaming industry with video games, a lot of the video games promote inappropriate ideas and inappropriate concepts. When you look at the phone games that are coming out of South Korea and China, Japan is also competing in that market as well with their own brand of, you know, inappropriate games. You know, Korea and China really are the two biggest leaders in terms of social media influence. And of course, you have something like K-pop, which is from South Korea, which is huge everywhere. The system that's generating all these K-pop celebrities, not a good thing that's going on with the way that they're creating and generating these K-pop idols. And then with the phone games, it's also scary because there's so many young people, you know, of course, targeted to young men that are being destabilized by these kind of phone games and by social media. So these issues aren't just contained within these countries themselves, but it's actually having a global effect. And when it affects the young people, that's when you know it's going to set up the next generation for failure if they don't unbind themselves from these unhealthy practices. And maybe I'll go into that more in the next episode. I think I'll probably dive into the effects of social media on young men. People do say that it affects women to a certain extent. That is true. But it has when young men are affected, it has a worse effect on society and on the culture at large. And I guess I can dive into that more on why that is in the next episode. But for now, that's everything I have to say on this issue, on these topics for this episode. Let me know what you think in the comments. And also, really quick, I do want to promote a new album that I released. It's on Spotify. It's a new project that I've been making by the name of Armed Civilian. So you can check it out on Spotify. Also have a YouTube page, and that's Armed Civilian. This is a death metal project. If you don't like death metal, I guess don't even bother checking it out. But if you're interested, go ahead and check it out. And here's a little bit of my new music, Armed Civilian. The new album is out, One World Under Wrath. Here's a brief clip of the song, Behold a Pale Horse. That's what you live for.